The Panzer VIII Maus stands as Germany's most fearless trial in extremely heavy tank warfare. A so-called wonder weapon, originated under Hitler's order and engineered by Ferdinand Porsche. Weighing in at an astonishing 188 tons, the Maus is recognized as the heaviest fully enclosed armored fighting vehicle ever built. Its enormous turret was designed to install a 128mm KWK 44L/55 gun, supported by a formidable 220mm of frontal armor, promising cutting-edge weaponry and highly resistant armor. However, this massive weight severely limited movement. The tank's top speed was 20 to 22 kilometers per hour, and even the advantage of very wide tracks could not overcome the obstacles posed by soft ground and load restrictions enforced by many bridges. In addition, groundbreaking features, such as a hybrid electric transmission and a creative system for river crossing using paired tanks, highlighted the advanced engineering behind the design. Yet persistent mechanical issues, logistical nightmares, and constant production delays ultimately doomed the project. Although the program was canceled in 1943, the Maus continues to intrigue as a symbol of desperate battle time vision, with its only remaining combined prototype now displayed at the Kubinka Tank Museum. From as early as 1941, when the German High Command was envisioning revolutionary military technologies, the Maus emerged amidst a wave of projects that promised to change the face of warfare. While some of these wonder weapons eventually evolved into foundational elements of modern arsenals, such as assault rifles, intercontinental ballistic missiles, and jet fighters, the Maus was an outlier. It embodied not only technical ambition, but also the erratic decision-making of Hitler, who seemed compelled to outdo Allied designs despite Germany's own dwindling resources. At a time when the loss of African oil fields had rendered fuel scarce, commissioning a gas-guzzling 188-ton behemoth was as paradoxical as it was extravagant. While American engineers were refining the 45-ton M26 Pershing, and the Russians had introduced the 45-ton JS-2 Stalin, Hitler's fixation on a tank that could outgun and outweigh its adversaries perplexed his own staff. The developmental journey of the Maus began in earnest when Krupp started studies of Soviet super heavy tanks, particularly the KV series, in 1941. By early 1942, Krupp had produced design studies for a hybrid Tiger-Maus prototype, later designated the Panzerkampfwagen 8, and had also conceptualized a predecessor known as the Panzerkampfwagen 7th Low, or Lion. In early March 1942, an order was placed for the heavier design, consigning the Low to history. Porsche was awarded the official contract to create the 188-ton Maus, with clear specifications. The tank was to carry 100 rounds of ammunition and be armed with either a high-performance 105mm L/60 or L/72 gun. While Porsche was responsible for developing the chassis, the Krupp Munitions Works was charged with constructing the hull, turret, and armament. Endorsed by the Heereswaffenamt as a competitive design, the project may also have served as a form of recompense for Porsche's earlier setbacks, with the ambitious directive even including the notion of an indestructible machine. The contract required an operational prototype by the spring of 1943. On June 23, 1942, Porsche submitted an improved design featuring turret-mounted 150mm L-37 and 105mm L-70 guns, and he promised that the first prototype would be ready by May 1943. Although the original specifications dictated a 150mm L-40 gun, coupled with a 20mm MG-150-120 heavy machine gun, alternatives such as the 128mm L-50 were under serious consideration. By December 1942, additional armaments, including a 127mm naval gun and the 128mm flak gun, were also undergoing tests. In January 1943, Hitler intervened, ordering that the turret be fitted with a 128mm and a 75mm gun. while future designs would eventually incorporate even larger weapons, 150 millimeters or 170 millimeters. The standard 7.9 millimeter coaxial machine gun was replaced by a 75 millimeter anti-tank gun positioned alongside the main armament, and an anti-aircraft machine cannon was slated for the turret roof, supplemented by a smoke grenade projector. Moreover, the requirement for 100 rounds of ammunition storage had to be compromised, as space was reduced to allow for further modifications in armament. Porsche's schedule soon slipped. By January 1943, he admitted that the first vehicle would not be ready until the summer, with production rates adjusted to only 5 units per month. Initially designated the VK-10001 Porsche, Type 205 and nicknamed Mammoth, the tank underwent a series of renamings, first to Mäuschen in December 1942, and finally to Maus in 1943. February 1943. Assembly of the components was handled by Alkett, and on December 24, 1943, the first prototype, lacking an actual turret, was completed and put through rigorous tests. These tests revealed that the tank struggled to move under its own power. Its Daimler-Benz MB-509 engine, derived from the DB-603 aircraft engine, could only propel the Maus at 13 kilometers per hour under ideal conditions, far short of the promised 20 kilometers per hour. A simulated turret, designed to mimic the weight of the planned structure, was later affixed. By March 1944, the second prototype, known as the Maus, was finished. Though initially without an engine, which was installed by mid-1944. On April 9th, Krupp delivered a turret that, once mounted and tested in June, was armed with a 128mm KWK 44L55 gun, a coaxial 75mm KWK 44L/36.5 gun, and a 7.92mm MG-34 machine gun. This formidable setup enabled the Maus to penetrate the armor of American Shermans, British Cromwells, and Churchills, as well as Russian T-34 and JS-2 tanks at ranges exceeding 3,500 meters. Despite the turret featuring mounts for a Zeiss rangefinder, several components were missing and delivered later, while plans for a second turret never materialized. By late July 1944, Krupp reported that additional hulls were in production, but orders to scrap these were issued just 2 days later. Testing resumed on the second prototype in September 1944 with a Daimler-Benz MB-517 diesel engine, yet even engines rated at approximately 1,200 horsepower failed to push the Maus beyond 10 to 12 miles per hour. The engineering challenges of the Maus were as monumental as the machine itself. Traditional torsion bar suspension used in vehicles like the Panther and Tiger was abandoned in favor of a volute spring system that was believed to better distribute the tank's immense weight. Its running gear, designed by Skoda, featured double-wheeled trucks supported by 12 return rollers and extraordinarily wide 43.3-inch tracks that occupied over 7 feet of its 12-foot width. Although these design choices were intended to reduce ground pressure, they also gave the Maus an unusual and somewhat ungainly appearance, with a 12-foot overall height making it an easy target. Strict dimensional limits were imposed to ensure the tank could be transported by rail, leading to the production of a specialized 14-axle railroad car by the Graz Simmering Pocher Works in Vienna. Further complicating matters were production delays and repeated engine failures, problems exacerbated by relentless Allied bombing raids on German factories. These setbacks meant that any breakdown of the Maus often required it to be towed by two other tanks, highlighting the impracticality of such an enormous vehicle in a rapidly evolving battlefield environment. Moreover, the large openings in the hull, necessary for adequate ventilation, along with the inclusion of an external auxiliary fuel tank, a significant fire hazard, rendered the Maus especially vulnerable to close-range attacks. Despite its myriad flaws, the Maus also served as a platform for ambitious engineering experiments. An auxiliary power plant was integrated to pressurize the crew compartment, thereby enabling limited submersion to depths theoretically up to 45 feet, though in practice only about 25 feet, which would have offered some protection against gas and chemical warfare. This system, equipped with built-in fans and ventilators to supply oxygen when all hatches were sealed, also featured a massive cylindrical chimney designed to function as an emergency escape route. An innovative electric transmission and steering system, first employed on the Elephant Assault Gun in 1943, was adapted for the Mouse, and an ingenious method was devised for paired tanks to ford rivers, with one unit powering the electric system of its companion via cable. However, questions remained about how to manage the final vehicle in such a tag-team arrangement. Production delays, persistent engine issues, and the inherent difficulties of scaling up armored vehicle technology to such extreme proportions eventually proved insurmountable. The Mouse's design also spurred studies into alternate variants. Allied discovered plans for a bear version, envisioned a 1,500-ton monster armed with an 800-millimeter breech-loading main gun and two auxiliary turrets mounting 150-millimeter guns each, while another concept, the flax-wheeling 8.8 centimeters off-Mouse, proposed converting the tank into a heavy anti-aircraft platform armed with twin 88-millimeter flak 43 guns. Ultimately, on November 4, 1943, Hitler ordered the cessation of all work on the Mouse. The original order for 150 vehicles was canceled, and only a single unit was slated for further evaluation. Some accounts even suggest that Hitler's true intention was to deploy the Mouse as a coastal defense measure along the Atlantic, where its limited range and mobility would have been less of a liability, though production delays ensured that any such plans would have come long after the D-Day landings. Today, the Mouse remains a subject of fascination among military historians and engineers alike. Despite its inherent flaws and the impracticalities that doomed its operational viability, the Mouse symbolizes the extremes of wartime ambition and the drive to push engineering boundaries under extraordinary circumstances. Its legacy endures as a stark reminder of how hubris and innovation can intertwine, leaving behind a machine that was as much a technological marvel as it was a cautionary tale.